Namaskar. These were pictures from our prayer meeting to pay tribute to former External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj, who passed away last week. Political leaders remembered her as an outstanding parliamentarian and a great human being. We will get to all those reactions and all the news in the next half an hour. But first, let's begin with the headlines. Steadfast in her views and an inspiration for party activists, says Prime Minister Narendra Modi while paying tributes to late BJP veteran Sushma Swaraj. Union Home Minister Amit Shah, other ministers and leaders of the various parties also pay tributes to the former Union Minister at a prayer meeting in Delhi's Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium. Supreme Court refuses to order lifting of restrictions in Jammu and Kashmir. Apex Court says adequate time should be given to central government to normalize situation. State administration announces three-day global investors summit from October 12th to 14th. Supreme Court refuses to extend deadline for final draft of National Register of Citizens, issues order to publish final NRC on August 31st itself, wants arrangements to be made for protecting data related to NRC. Major political development in Sikkim. 10 out of 13 MLAs of Paman Kumar Chamling's party Sikkim Democratic Front joined BJP in Delhi in presence of party's working president JP Nadda. And big relief on the inflation front. Retail prices fall to a six-month low. Retail inflation rate in July was 3.15% compared to 3.18% in June and 4.17% in July 2018. The Supreme Court on Tuesday refused to pass any immediate order to the centre on lifting restrictions imposed after the abrogation of Article 370 in Jammu and Kashmir. Hearing a PIL on the issue, the Apex Court said that it will wait for normalcy to return and take up the matter after 2 weeks. Meanwhile, restrictions in parts of Kashmir continued for the 10th day on Tuesday, even as the Jammu region remained almost entirely free of any restriction. Prohibitory conditions were relaxed in various parts of Kashmir. Jammu and Kashmir administration has said curbs would be relaxed in parts of the valley in a phased manner. He added that medical services of all kinds are continuing normally and unhindered. Jammu and Kashmir administration also announced that it will host a three-day global investor summit from October 12th in Srinagar.
And successful conclusion of Eid prayers, prohibitory conditions were further relaxed in various parts. As we speak, the Jammu region is almost entirely free of restrictions. Restrictions, however, do continue in parts of Kashmir based on local assessment. As I mentioned, the overall policy continues to be relaxations and easing out. Routine OPDs, admissions and surgical procedures continue to be carried out. Medicines, both normal and emergency, and life-saving drugs are available in adequate supply. We have had movement of 100 heavy vehicles, including trucks with supplies, oil tankers, gas tankers, LPG trucks. Similarly, we have had movement of 14 to 1500 LMVs as well as buses. Flight operations continue to be normal. As we speak, dress rehearsals for the forthcoming Independence Day are being carried out in all districts of Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh.
And the full dress rehearsal for the Independence Day celebrations went off peacefully in Srinagar on Wednesday. Several batches of Jammu and Kashmir police personnel, paramilitary forces and other participants took part in the rehearsals at Sher-e Kashmir Stadium.
पंद्रह अगस्त की तैयारी जो है हमारी वो बराबर इस वक्त चल रही है, आपने देखा है उसको। और 15 अगस्त का फंक्शन भी हम लोग ये समझते हैं कि बहुत अच्छे से निकलेगा, उसकी तैयारियां भी सब जिलों में चल रही हैं। और अभी जो श्रीनगर में 15 अगस्त का फंक्शन होने वाला, उसका नमूना आपने अभी देखा है।
हमारा सबका फर्ज है, देखिए जहाँ एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन और पुलिस है, हम सब चाहते हैं और हम हमारी यही अंतक कोशिश है कि लोग खुशहाल रहें, खुशी रहें, हर तरह से हम उनको ताउन दे रहे हैं और खुश रहें। जितना भी हमसे हो सकता है, आपने देखा होगा एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन से चाहे किसी भी तरीके से लोगों तक पहुँचना है, हम पूरा पहुँचे हैं और आगे भी हम ऐसे ही रहेंगे। सिर्फ मेरा पैगाम यह है, जैसे डीजी साहब ने फरमाया कि लोगों से हमारी यही दरख्वास्त है कि वो खुशहाली से रहें, अमन अमान से रहें और एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन का पूरा साथ।
एंड सोशल मीडिया प्लेटफॉर्म ट्विटर इंडिया ऑन ट्यूसडे सस्पेंडेड 4 ट्विटर हैंडल्स फॉर एलिजिडली स्प्रेडिंग एंटी इंडिया प्रोपेगेंडा ऑन जम्मू एंड कश्मीर। The center on Monday had asked Twitter to suspend 8 accounts for allegedly spreading anti-India propaganda. And in the news just coming in, classes in the University of Jammu will resume from Wednesday. The university is closed since the security clampdown last Monday. All undergraduate and postgraduate examinations were also postponed. Let's now go across to Dr. Vinay Tuso, official spokesperson of the University of Jammu and Kashmir, for more information on this. Dr. Vinay Tuso, thank you so much for speaking to Rajya Sabha Television. The current situation has caused disruption in the studies and academics in Jammu and Kashmir. What is the university planning to help the students?
We had a meeting a couple of days before where it was chaired by the Vice Chancellor, University of Jammu, Professor Manoj Da. This whole situation was discussed in detail while all the major officials were there. And it was decided that, you know, in the days to come, we'll try to cope up with all this backlogs by holding extra classes for the student as well as whole classes and keep the administration open at the weekends also.
Right.
And there is, yeah.
Right. And the exams have been postponed. By when should we expect them to be rescheduled?
Tomorrow we are holding a meeting with the controller examination. While you are going to, the controller examination is going to take a call on it. Until 14, we have cleared, we are postponed all the exams. But from tomorrow onwards, we are going to release we're going to release fresh schedule of, you know, fresh schedule update sheet. Hopefully by 19 onwards, all the examinations will be held as per the schedule.
Right. And how is the university gearing up to face the current situation?
We have taken all the precautions which are in place as of now. First, you know, we already opened the university on 10th of this month, where the teaching was suspended, but the administration, because of the order administration, where Section 144 was lifted up, and it was also issued an order that schools and colleges will remain open. Based on that, university evaluated the situation on ground. It was decided that teaching will remain suspended, but however, administration, non-teaching staff will come to the university and check out a further course action. And it was decided on the meeting, same meeting, that 14 onwards, we are going to keep our university functioning very much normal. And for tomorrow, we have every preparation in place. We are going to, you know, receive our fresh batch of the students, because we are already late in the admission process. But we have, you know, we have already notified a rescheduled admission, you know, admission program. So tomorrow onwards, all this merit list will be pasted in every department is going to issue the fresh list of merit list. And from 16 onwards, we are starting full throttle admissions in the University of Jammu.
Right. And any special steps to reassure the safety of students?
As I said to you earlier, that we had a meeting, high-level meeting. Everything was discussed. Every top functionary of the university system was involved in that. Every system, every mechanism has been put in place so that students of the University of Jammu, who also come from far-flung areas, don't suffer any brawl. If they do suffer anything, we are always there to help them out. But as far as our understanding is concerned, we don't think there is anything wrong is going to happen in the campus.
Right. Thank you so much, Mr. Tuso, for joining us and giving us all those in-depth news from Jammu and Kashmir. So remember, the University of Jammu will resume from Wednesday. The university is closed since the security clamped down last Monday. All the undergraduate and postgraduate examinations have been postponed. And as per the conversation with Dr. Vinay Tuso, he told us that there is a speculation that from 19th, the examinations which have been postponed will be rescheduled. And our correspondent Vishal Dahiya spoke to Prasar Bharati Chairman A. Surya Prakash on abrogation of Article 370. Let's listen in.
Article, recent article which you have written, yeah, that clearly mentions how the situation, you know, years ago in 1960s was very different for some of these political parties. So could you explain it a little further?
Yeah, actually, you know, from the 1950s onwards, you see, soon after independence, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel had the responsibility to integrate all these princely states. There were 564 states. So he cajoled, bamboozled, you call it what, and he got all of them to become part of the Indian Union. Mm-hmm. And that included the state of Jammu and Kashmir. A lot of negotiations went on with many states. So that is why that whole integration process was remarkably carried out by Sardar Patel.
How do you see the implications, the effects of this step vis-a-vis the integration parts?
Wherever I travel in India, I meet Kashmiri youth studying in universities. Wherever I go in India, I see Kashmiri youth who are well qualified in the best of Indian corporations and companies. I have seen Kashmiri businessmen doing business in Hampi, you know, which is that great archaeological site in Karnataka. Mm-hmm. Belur, Halebid, you go anywhere, go to any tourist destination in India, you will see Kashmiri businessmen. So this is what is open to them, available to the Kashmiri youth and Kashmiri, every resident and citizen of India who resides in Kashmir. This is what is available to him, just as this is what is available to all of us. Mm-hmm. But because of 370, none of us could go to Kashmir to do business or to study or to settle down or whatever. Mm-hmm. There is no restriction on any Kashmiri settling down in Karnataka, Maharashtra, Punjab or wherever.
Okay.
So this anomaly, I think, had to be removed also because it is very critical to the whole idea of integration of India.
Okay. Last question before we bring this to an end is about how the situation is since last few days, a week or so, in the state specifically, and how it is being projected by certain sections. So how do you look at that?
When we talk of Jammu, state of Jammu and Kashmir, mm-hmm. that state which prevailed before abrogation of 370, mm-hmm. constantly everyone's mind is on what is happening in the valley, what does the valley think of it. I think that is wrong. There are people living in Ladakh, there are people living in Jammu. Look at the geography. 85% of that geography, you are not taking that into account. I think we need to correct that. Mm-hmm. I think people of India need to understand this. And then slowly the integration process will happen. Mm-hmm. As regards international media, you know, referring to the state of Jammu and Kashmir as Indian administered Kashmir is absolutely ridiculous. The state of Jammu and Kashmir is like the state of Mysore, Travancore, Bhopal, what have you. These are all states which integrated into the Indian Union mm-hmm. over that period of time after we got independence. 564 states. It is one of those states. So we'll imagine an international media describing Maharashtra mm-hmm. as Indian administered Maharashtra.
Very much an integral part of India as Maharashtra or as Travancore or as Mysore.
And we as citizens of India, as a citizen of India, I feel very offended when somebody refers to a state in my country as an Indian administered state. Absolutely ridiculous. We must challenge that. We must change this narrative. We should not accept it.
With camera person Prashant Karmakar, this is Vishal Dahiya for Rajya Sabha Television in Delhi.
And weather news now, the death toll in flood-affected four districts has reached over 200 with more than 12 lakh people displaced. The death toll in the Kerala floods increased to 88 on Tuesday, with an extremely heavy rain warning issued for three districts of Ernakulam, Idukki and Alappuzha. The toll is likely to go up as 40 people are still missing. The flood situation in several districts of Maharashtra also remain critical, even as water levels have started to recede. The death toll due in five districts, including Sangli, Kolhapur, Satara, Pune and Cholapur, has risen to 43. Over 4 lakh people have been evacuated from 584 villages. The situation is also improving in flood and heavy rain-affected districts of Karnataka, and inflows in reservoirs are also steadily decreasing. Over 6 lakh people have been evacuated in the past week. The rain fury has left 48 people dead in the state, while 16 are missing. Odisha too, which is being battered by heavy showers since last week on Tuesday, saw a flood-like situation in parts of the state. 8 people have died in the flood-related incidents in the state. And some more developments. Supreme Court ordered that the list of those excluded from the final Assam NRC be published only online on August 31st. A bench comprising Chief Justice Ranjan Gogoi and Justice R.F. Nariman said that, like Aadhaar data, an appropriate regime should be enacted for securing the Assam NRC data. The Apex Court also said that the ongoing NRC exercise cannot be ordered to be reopened on the basis of certain legal challenges raised before it. The top court had earlier said that the final Assam NRC would be published on or by August 31st. Meanwhile, in a big relief to the home buyers, the Supreme Court has directed the Noida and Greater Noida authorities to start registration of flats in the beleaguered home buyers. The Apex Court also warned that the officers of both the authorities will be sent to jail if there is any delay on their part in handling over the possession of flats to the buyers. The top court also said that project-wise list of home buyers be provided to both the authorities within 3 days. Pronouncing its judgment in the case of pertaining to the pending projects of Amrapali Group, the top court had last month faulted banks, Noida and Greater Noida authorities for the ongoing mess at the real estate company. Cancelling Amrapali's RERA registration, the Apex Court has asked state-run NBCC to complete pending projects of Amrapali Group. Political developments now. 10 MLAs of the Sikkim Democratic Front joined the BJP today in presence of party's working president JP Nadda and BJP leader Ram Madhav. Barring Sikkim's former chief minister Pawan Kumar Chambling, all other legislators joined the BJP. Speculations relating to their joining of the BJP came to the fore when the 10 SDF legislators met the BJP National General Secretary Ram Madhav in New Delhi recently. The SDF delegation had 10 of the 13 party MLAs, excluding party president Chambling, Dungale and Sharma. The delegation was led by senior SDF leaders and former ministers. Sikkim was the only state in Northeast where the BJP was not in power.
SDF सिक्किम में आज विपक्षी दल है तो अब ये विधायक हमारे पार्टी में आए हैं तो अब बीजेपी वहां एक कंस्ट्रक्टिव अपोजिशन के रूप में उस राज्य में अपना दायित्व निभाएगी आगे जाकर संगठन लेजिस्लेटिव पार्टी की व्यवस्था वगैरह आगे जाकर निर्णय किए जाएंगे.
And retail inflation eased marginally in July to 3.15% over the previous month. The ease in the consumer price index-based retail inflation came on the back of softening fuel and light prices, even as inflation in the overall food basket moved up. Retail inflation was 3.18% in June 2019, while it stood at 4.17% in July last year. As per the data released by the Central Statistics Office, the inflation in the food basket was 2.36% in July, marginally up from 2.25% in June. The rate of price rise in vegetables softened to 2.82% during July as against a rise of 4.66% in June. Prices of pulses and products went up to 6.82% from 5.68%. In fuel and light category, deflation was witnessed minus 0.36% as against a rise of 2.32% in June. A condolence meeting to pay tribute to the former External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj was organized by the Bharatiya Janata Party at Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium on Tuesday. Prime Minister Narendra Modi, Home Minister Amit Shah, Defence Minister Rajnath Singh and many other senior cabinet ministers and BJP leaders were in attendance to pay their tribute to the stalwart. Swaraj passed away on the night of August 6th following a cardiac arrest.
उम्र में भले मुझसे छोटी थी लेकिन मैं सार्वजनिक रूप से कहना चाहूंगा कि मुझे उनसे बहुत कुछ सीखने को मिलता था. सुषमा जी की एक विशेषता, यहां कोई लोग बोलने की हिम्मत नहीं कर रहे शायद, वे मृदु थी, वो नम्र थी, वो ममता से भरी थी, सब था, लेकिन कभी कभी उनकी जबान में पक्का हरियाणवी टच भी रहता था. हरियाणवी टच के साथ बात को फटाक से कहना और उसमें टच से मस न होना भीतर से कन्विक्शन के रूप में प्रकट होता था, ये उनकी एक विशेषता थी.
भारतीय जनता पार्टी के नेता के नाते कई दशकों तक भारतीय जनता पार्टी के कार्यकर्ताओं का मार्गदर्शन किया. 75 से लेकर आज तक की इतनी लंबी राजनीतिक करियर कहीं पर किसी के साथ कोई कटुता करे बगैर सबको साथ में रखकर कैसे आगे बढ़ा जाता है उसका उन्होंने एक उत्कृष्ट उदाहरण राजनीतिक क्षेत्र के अंदर काम करने वाले लोगों के लिए पेश किया है। विदेश विभाग में जब वो प्रधानमंत्री मोदी जी के नेतृत्व में मंत्री बने, विदेश विभाग को जनता के साथ जोड़ना ये इनकी सबसे बड़ी उपलब्धि रही।
लोग उसने कुशल राजनेता कहते हैं, जन नेता कहते हैं, लेकिन मैं यह कहता हूं कि वह जन नेता ही नहीं थी बल्कि जन मन की नेता थी। लोगों के दिलों को जीता, सक्रिय राजनीति में भूमिका निभाने वाले बिरले लोग ऐसे हुआ करते हैं जो लोगों के मन पर राज करते हैं। सुषमा जी ने अपने राजनीतिक जीवन में लोगों के मन पर भी राज किया है।
वो कद की छोटी थी, व्यक्तित्व बहुत बड़ा था, हृदय भी बहुत बड़ा था, सोच विशाल थी, देश के प्रति समर्पित थे और अपनी विचारधारा के लिए उनकी प्रतिबद्धता अटल थी। मैंने सुषमा जी का नाम पहली बार 1977 में सुना था जब हरियाणा में चुनाव जीत कर आई थी। उसके बाद उनको सुना, उस समय टेलीविजन नहीं हुआ था, होते थे कभी रेडियो पर, कभी अखबार में पढ़ा।
And the Union Cabinet paid tribute to former Union Minister Sushma Swaraj, who passed away last week at Ames following a cardiac arrest. In the morning meeting, the Cabinet adopted a resolution which said that Swaraj will always be remembered for her exceptional oratory skills and a compassionate approach. The Cabinet described her as an affable person with a humane touch, who won the hearts of all by helping Indians in distress abroad. In her passing away, the country has lost a distinguished leader and an outstanding parliamentarian, said the cabinet resolution. The Central Board of Direct Taxes has rebutted recent reports about income tax notices being issued to Durga Puja committees in Kolkata. Refuting the media reports unequivocally, CPDT asserted that the reports are factually incorrect. It said that no notice was issued to the Durga Puja Committee Forum by the Department of Revenue this year. However, the official statement said that notices under Section 133(6) of the Income Tax Act 1961 was issued in December last year to about 30 committees, seeking details of tax deducted at source on payments made to contractors and event managers for puja events. The statement reiterated that the exercise was in no manner against the puja committees, but to ensure that contractors and event managers pay their due taxes correctly within the stipulated time. Housing and Urban Affairs Minister Hardeep Singh Puri launched Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020 in New Delhi on Tuesday. He said that Swachh Bharat Mission has become a people's movement through active participation by the public. The fifth edition of the annual cleanliness survey will be conducted in January next year.
That process will culminate, and I say with a great deal of satisfaction, in a successful manner on 2nd October 2019, when we celebrate the 150th birth anniversary of the Mahatma. The Prime Minister had said when he launched the scheme that a fitting tribute to the father of the nation would be if we can achieve Swachhata in terms of the parameters that he had outlined, and these were: number one, to make India open defecation free by 2nd October 2019, and two, to have solid scientific waste management throughout the country.
And giving a new ambience and aesthetics to the parliament, permanent colorful lights have been installed on its exterior ahead of the Independence Day celebrations. To enhance the parliament building's grandeur, a special system of LED lights which will change color has been installed on its facade and Prime Minister Narendra Modi has inaugurated it on Tuesday. We leave you with these visuals. Thank you for watching. Namaskar.